So Shannon, in origin, there were two really, you know, important theorems he had. The first had to do with compression. He showed that entropy was the right measure.
This is Rüdiger Urbanke, a full professor of the IC school at EPFL. And in a previous video, we discussed the compression part of Shannon's 1948 paper. In particular, in this paper, Shannon
showed that entropy is the right measure to describe how many bits in average you will need to describe that source. So that was his first theorem. And then his second theorem had to do with defining in a mathematical way what was the capacity of a channel. So what was its ability to carry information. And he showed, again, there was first a functional description. So you give me first a mathematical model for the channel in terms of some probability distribution. So if you have this input, what is the output? What is the probability to get the various outputs? Okay, so that's the description of the channel. And once you give me this description of the channel, again, as in entropy, you can compute a number. And then he showed that this number is the capacity. And up to this number, you can push bits through that channel reliably. But if you're trying to do more than that, you invariably will have a significant error probability. Okay, so these are really these two important theorems that originally he had in his 1948 paper.
What's fascinating about Shannon's 1948 paper is that he proved that any communication channel had a fundamental channel capacity and that communication should be adapted to this capacity.
The communications part has two things. There's a source, right? And the source could be a picture that you want to send, maybe my voice. I want to communicate using my voice, maybe a fax that you want to send, right? And so it turns out that if you're not concerned about delays and some other problems, that you can basically split the communications problems in two ways. You first take a source and you compress it to as few bits as possible, okay? And so that is exactly down to the entropy. And so that's important to know, what is the entropy of a certain source. And then you take these bits that describe the source, and now you have the second problem, and that's the communications problem. And now your task is to take these bits, send them over what's called a channel, so some physical medium, could be a wireless, could be a fiber optic cable, could be a phone line, okay? And the idea now is that you want to send these bits over that channel such that at the receiver, with high probability, you know exactly what the bits were. Okay, so that's a second part. And now you have already compressed your source down to as little as possible. You send now these bits. At the receiver, you reconstruct the bits, and then you reconstruct from the source the actual image. And that's, in principle, at least asymptotically, the optimum way of transmitting information.
Now, if you assume that nothing bad happens during the communication, then communication becomes a relatively easy problem. The trouble is that, in practice, most communication channels are noisy.
Most channels are not of the form where I'm sending, let's say, a bit in, a zero and one in, and I will simply get exactly that bit out, right? That's what's called a noiseless channel. Most channels will introduce some kind of perturbation, right? Now, in information theory, we take the actual physical medium and we transform it into a mathematical model. So the mathematical model might be the channel takes at every point of time in a bit in, a zero and one, and then what comes out is maybe with a high probability the same bit, but with a certain probability it gets flipped or it will be replaced by what's called an erasure. You just don't know what it was or some other perturbation. Now that's a mathematical model of what happens. The actual physical model can be much more complicated, right? So you send, for example, an electromagnetic wave via an antenna, and there's another antenna that receives this wave, right? And so that might be the physical medium, or you could send photons over an optical channel, and that might be the physical channel that actually happens. The important part is that if you wanted to model every single detail that was in a physical communication, it would be super, super complicated. And most of the details are completely irrelevant to whether or not this information, this channel can carry information. So there's first a modeling phase in which you take the physical channel, you abstract a mathematical model to it, okay? And this model is particular to describe what is the input, what is the noise. The noise means just the perturbation that the channel introduces. And then what is then the outcome, okay? And once you have a mathematical model, you can associate to this channel what's called a capacity, so a maximum ability to carry reliable information. So how many bits per channel use can you carry over such a channel? Okay, and so an important part is this modeling of this noise. This noise can be the thermal noise that you see, you know, from just electrons moving around. It could be because there's a wind and simply the shadowing effect in wireless. It could be that in a photon source, there's some randomness introduced where the photon actually gets emitted or not. And there are many, many other effects what the physical thing is. But you abstract all this thing into a mathematical model of what a noise is. And so that's a very important component of the modeling part.
Okay, so most communication channels are noisy. Most channels are not fully reliable. So how can we reliably transmit data through such noisy channels?
It's something that we're all familiar with. If, let's assume we didn't have this conversation here with the door closed and relatively quiet, but let's assume we were in a very noisy room, right? Then we would still be able to talk, and we all know that we can talk in a bar. And most of the time we would understand each other. And why is that? Because language, let's say English language or any other language, has a lot of what's called redundancy in there. So there are a lot of, there are a lot of dependencies in there that you know, like how a sentence is structured. So many of the words you could simply emit and you would still understand what actually the sentence was. Once in a while, it's not true, right? If I'm saying, tomorrow I'm flying to, and then you don't hear, well, it could be Paris, it could be London, it could be Lausanne, right? And if you don't have any prior knowledge, you might not know. But maybe some other of the words or some parts of the words you can easily omit. You can also try this in written language and you will still understand.
Let's give an example. Here's a text with missing bits. Can you still understand it? You probably can. And this is because the English language is very redundant. You can write a text and misspell words, and yet the core information of the message will still be there.
And with communication, it's the same way. You don't just take the bits you actually want to transmit, but you add a few extra bits. And that's what's called redundancy. And these bits depend on the bits you actually want to transmit. And so then no matter which part of the bits get lost or get perturbed, you're using this dependency that you have in the bits to reconstruct what was actually transmitted. And as long as the noise is not too large, it's not, you know, not too many of the bits are hidden, perturbed, then with very high probability, you can still reconstruct what was said. And so that's the idea of coding. Coding is exactly first expanding the source, adding more bits. Decoding is taking all these bits in, some of them perturbed, and reconstructing the original information.
Shannon also pointed followers in the right direction in their efforts to boost the efficiency of digital transmission or storage. He came up with the concept of adding extra so-called redundant bits to a message so that it could be reconstructed at the other end despite some corruption.
These days, that's not the only model that's important, right? Right now, you know, we have with Internet of Things, with things in the cloud, it's much more complicated.